All right, everyone, we are to the point where we can start detailing the rest of this entire model. And so far, this low poly silhouette, or just the very base mesh, is looking good. And like I said before, detailing a character is very easy. It doesn't take too long. Well, it depends how much detail you want to add into it. But it's easier to add detail than it is to delete detail. So keeping a low poly mesh as low as possible is very important. It's also the most versatile way of working, because if you have low poly mesh, you can always increase the subdivisions using mudbox and start sculpting as high res as you want, and you can just add detail. Whereas going backwards from a high poly model to a low poly model is very, very difficult. So you want to keep this, definitely save this as a separate file, and we can begin modeling some of the details in. Now, before we start, we've got to make a few decisions. We are going to create the eyes, the ears, the low poly fur we're going to do a little bit later. We're just going to add the teeth, start molding in or modeling in those folds in that t-shirt right there. And we'll have to add an extra mesh. This will be the cloth fold down below. This will be a cloth sim, so we'll add that a little bit later. It's actually not too hard. And the decision that you have to make when you're adding detail is what can you add into the mesh and what can you add into just the texture. Small little folds can be added into the texture. Little things like, you know, tiny, tiny, subtle cloth fabric textures, you can add that inside the texture. But for larger things like this vest joint, we are going to model that into the character model mesh itself. And the reason is because we want this to read well. Your texture, a 2D texture, can only bring out so much of a character. And it's important for you to just, where possible, the major elements, just model it into the character itself. There's usually no reason to rely on just textures. Of course, it's not the only way to get the detail out. You can definitely use a high-res sculpting tool and just start creating some normals. But in essence, we want to just create some of those thick folds, those major creases in that fold there, just to bring out that detail a little bit more. Of course, we've got this little belt tab and a few little extra things we can add in a little bit later. So the first thing we're going to do, we are going to start modeling this vest here. And here's the reason why you want to keep your low poly model as low as possible, because when you're adding detail, you're going to add a lot of mesh, a lot of polygons really quickly. So it's always a good idea to begin simple. So more than ever, we are going to be using the reference image, and let's start creating some of those folds there. So I'm going to split that edge loop right there, and this top edge loop, I'm going to just pull it up and out and start adjusting some of these vertices until I'm reasonably happy with the general appearance of that. And already, with just one edge loop, you can see we've already got that fold there. We can harden those edges. We'll probably have to do that a little bit later, but we can just harden those edges when we're done to make sure we get that effect right. I think I didn't do that right, but that's okay. Don't panic. So once you harden the edges, you can see that vest detail will come out. The other thing we want to do is just this inside here. There's actually two cloth segments, but we are going to break a few rules, and one of the rules was, keep quads and such little things like that. We're going to break those rules because, hey, I'm a rebel by nature. We are going to start with just splitting that top edge there, and I'm not going to be following the reference per se in the sense that I want to be perfectly true to that reference. I want to actually follow the mesh, and that's actually important because we are going to clean up this mesh a little bit. And one thing I'm trying to avoid is hitting those corners right there. I don't want to hit those corners because it's just going to make cleaning this up a little bit difficult. I'm trying to be consistent with where I'm putting my cuts, and as always, I'm trying to just get a general idea of where that cloth is going to extrude and where it's going to end. Like I said, I'm breaking a few rules, and that's okay at this stage because, well, in essence, we have to do that to get the result that we want. So what I'm doing now is starting to cut some areas down here, and this will be where we lift the mesh up from that area so we can bring that cloth out. Now this is where things can get a little bit messy, and actually it will get messy, so if you are afraid to get your hands dirty, then well, just get used to it, because we're going to start pushing a few things in and deleting some vertices and edges. And the reason why it's going to get complicated is because when we're cleaning this up, we are going to be creating a lot of weird n-gons. So knowing where to cut and where not to cut is quite important, and this will take a little bit of experience, and it's okay if you're not sure how. It's actually very difficult for me to sort of put that in the tutorial, because where you cut and where you what you delete and where you cut can be very different for different models. So it will help if you just have a good idea of how splitting polygons work and what will work, what you can add, what you can delete. It takes a little bit of experience, so don't be daunted if you don't know. I mean, I certainly took me a while for me to sort of get it. But in essence, again, the main aim is to try and get as, you know, clean quads as possible. Some areas you won't be able to get that, which is okay. But we'll just have to work with this and see where we go from here. So I'm going to keep going and see where how far I can take this. The other thing is, don't delete those little vertices in that edge there, because they're kind of holding the crease together. One of the reasons why I go between softened edge and hardened edge is so that I can actually see the faces. Sometimes you can't really tell when you have a soft edge or the smooth edged, so it just sort of helps to go between that every now and then, just so that you can gauge how well the model looks so far. And at the moment I'm reasonably happy with that. We've got good edge flow, we've got relatively good quads. There's a few adjustments we've got to make, I've got to make down here. But in essence, we have kind of achieved what we're trying to do, and that's just good edge flow. I think I missed one spot here. Again, keeping quads is only a general rule. You don't really have to. There are some instances where a triangle may be appropriate, especially if it's on complex models. Sometimes triangles, you can't really avoid them, but it's always a good idea to try to keep your quads as best as possible. So the detail of that so far looks reasonably good. I am going to continue doing that interior down there. So we're going to do the same principle as we did on the outside. We're just going to move it on the inside now. And as usual, I'm going to just judge it based on the mesh and the reference image. You don't want to do it too accurately to the image because sometimes the lines in the image don't match up with the mesh. So you want to sort of take into account where you want the mesh to go. In my case, I am trying to end it there. So that's where that collar sort of finishes. So I'm going to just slice it upwards towards that edge. And again, I'm going to do a new duplicate of that same edge. So this is one way to extrude your edges out. It's just to create double edges and then pull the outer one out or the inside in, depending on which one you're going for, and readjust your vertices. Now I just realized one mistake I did. I actually pulled that outside out. It's actually supposed to go inside because that is actually the collarbone, and we'll create a new one over here. And for us to clean up the rest of those edges, just so that we don't have seams when we connect the head, I'm just going to select those edges and just simply extrude a bit of a small, I'm not even sure what you call it anymore, but just a bit of a handle so that we've got a slight buffer for the head. This particular segment, it doesn't matter what it looks like, it's as long as it just sort of covers the head up a little bit. We can adjust this a little bit later, but I'm just throwing it in there for now so that we at least have something to sort of just as a small placeholder. So far our model is looking okay. We need to do a few adjustments here a little bit later down the track, but that's all right. We'll leave that for now. But we can move on to the small creases on the edge of that sleeve here. And as always, you're looking at your reference to see where those edges go. In my case, I want to try and keep, I don't want to be as messy as I was over here because like cleaning up does take a while. So I'm going to just use an edge loop and create two edge loops. And sort of just fold one half of that edge loop into the other. And this top one, I can do the same. except it will be on the top half there. So that looks like a nice rolled up sleeve. It sort of helps to sort of alternate those edges together. You don't have to add too much detail or too many subdivisions. You just need to sort of just get it to the point where it sort of reads well. So we've got a nice sleeve going, we've got great details happening down on this torso, and the rest, I'm actually going to leave the rest for the texturing, the texturing side of things. And one thing I do want to change is this little edge here, it's a bit large, so I might also add an extra edge loop division just so that we can hide that seam. And that's kind of the tricks of the trade when you're modeling. It's basically to make a model read well, you are essentially hiding seams. So if you can hide the seams in certain areas, you will find that even a single mesh model can bring a great illusion to your character. So that's looking good. We are going to move on to the feet this time. We're going to do just some small creases on the legs here. Again, I'm using my head in, I'm just working in my head how I want the creases to work. It doesn't have to be accurate. It doesn't have to be accurate to the reference, because these creases can be changed or edited anytime. The idea is to just make it work for the eye. And if it works for your eyes, then chances are it will work for the audiences. And one of the reasons why I'm using a split polygon tool manually is because the edge loop here is a little bit out of whack. And it's actually my fault because I didn't check some of these elements. And that's kind of the deal. Once you get to this point and you've made tiny little mistakes, it sort of trickles down into the rest of your model. So it's always important to take note of your mesh early on and just make sure you get it right. I'm just isolating this leg because it's a little bit tricky to split those polygons in that particular segment of the leg. And creases in a clothing have... There's a bit of a trick to get nice creases in your clothing, and I will show you in a minute. In essence, what you're doing when you're creating loops, you just want to... You want to sort of alternate... it's actually easy if I just show you. So after pressing Shift-I to isolate certain areas on the leg, I can quickly show you what I mean with creases on clothing. So with the polycylinder, I'm just going to set a 10 division height here, maybe less in terms of its size or width number. Okay, so creases in the clothing look a little bit like this. Some people, when they do creases in clothing, they kind of do that and then do that. And then do that, and that looks a little bit strange, so we're not going to do that. The trick to getting clothing right is to select one of those edge loops, and then get half of it down and push half of it in, get the top one down a little bit, and like the top, I'm going to push half of that in, just that half of that in, and then this half I'll push out. Okay, that's kind of the pattern. And then you do the same with the one on the bottom. You push half out and then you push half in. Just like that. Top here as well. So clothing kind of alternates in a very strange way. It sort of creases half of its mesh. That's really horrible. So that's just terrible, but you get the idea. You're getting half of that out and then half of that edge loop in. And I do apologize, this example is not the best, but that's the pattern you kind of want to follow when you're trying to do creases in the clothing. And that's actually what I did with the sleeves and the legs. That looks absolutely disgusting, but you get the point. That's kind of what I did here. You just make sure you tweak it to the point where it looks good to you. So if it looks good to you, it looks good. It'll look good to the audience. That's kind of the deal. I'm getting rid of that. That looks absolutely horrific. So just on kneecaps, I'm adding a slight crease down there, just so that on a profile view we can see that those pants aren't monotonous, and that's sort of the goal here, is to break up those smooth areas and, let people know that hey, this is a cloth. It's very loose. It's not just a small little tiny, it's a nice loose cloth. It's not straight, constantly straight. And by just adding those little tiny subtle details, you in effect you're making things more readable for the audience, and it will help just sort of bring the character model out a little bit. Okay, so far that's looking good. I'm quite happy with that, at least in my head. Subject to personal opinion, but in any case, I'm going to harden some of these edges up and commit to these final changes. And by hardening these edges, I am just making the model stand out, those creases, making those little creases stand out a little bit for the audience to see. And that's actually important because a model isn't always fully smooth. There are some segments where you have to sort of harden the edges and get that to sort of just pop out. So you can at least see how the areas, just certain areas can pop out very well, and most of the rest we can actually texture. So I'm going to make one small change to that because that edge there is a little bit harsh. It's okay to exaggerate some things, but sometimes they sort of, just are too exaggerated. You just want to loosen them up a little bit. And can you imagine trying to make changes if you have a model that's ridiculously complex? Then you can already see it can be a nightmare. So very important to stay as low poly as possible. That's kind of the goal. Get as much detail as you can with the least number of polygons. And the head is missing. I will pop the head up right there. So far, so good. The model is looking great. Let's start moving on to the head. And I'm going to put those legs on another layer. I think one habit people tend not to have is renaming some of their models, and it's quite crucial for you to maintain good name a good naming scheme. I've just called this Farmer One or whatever it is, and it just helps down it just helps to get good habits when you're doing something like this. It's basically cleaning up after yourself after cooking dinner. I have no idea why I brought that up, but it's oh dear, you could tell I am very sleepy. Okay, eyeball. Moving on, eyeball. Eyeball, I am going to keep this low poly. I can increase the number of this as much as I want later down the track, so just to start off with, we're going to keep it simple. And for this, I'm going to rotate this 90 degrees, just so that the top pole, and this is more for texturing purposes, it just makes it easier to texture, that top segment rather than the side. And we're going to put that eyeball in the head. Now, one of the things we have to remember is that the eyeball needs to, just the iris here, we need to be able to see the iris completely. So just resize your eyeball until you get that right. And remember when I said that this model, this head is actually not complete? It's actually true. We actually need to constantly be making adjustments as we add detail to it. So don't be afraid to do that, because it does help when you have when you're very loose, very flexible with your model. I just realized one thing, I kind of put that in the wrong place. But if you're flexible with your models, then you can adjust them down the track as you add detail. And you have to always expect that you're going to add more detail down the track, because it's just the fact of modeling. It will happen. There's very little you can do about that. You have to be constantly adjusting things and making it work. In this particular case, our eye is a little bit too shallow, so I'm going to just deepen that a little bit. And using the reference, I'm trying to achieve just a middle ground for the model here. And by adjusting that, I can sort of get the eyeball to come out the way I want. The other thing you want to keep in mind is, anatomy-wise, eyeballs tend to be one eyeball apart from each other. So if you have a rough indication just by using that eyeball there, if it looks a little bit like that, then your eyeballs are fairly accurate, even though they may not seem like that. So in my case, I'm just going to pull that out a little bit more because they are a bit too close together. And duplicate and minus X axis so that we get a nice read on that. So based on the reference image, it's looking okay. It's not accurate to the actual image itself. What we're trying to do is just find a middle ground. What we're trying to do is find a middle ground for the eyes, and that will require a little bit more tweaking down the track, but in essence, we have a fairly readable eyeball. Oops. And what I want to do is just make sure on the profile side, the eyeball can be visible as much as, just so that we can see it look a little bit like that. Like I said, the reference image is not completely accurate. It's all about just trying to get it to read well enough for the audience to see that, hey, this character's head is this character. That's basically it. All right, it's looking good. The other thing we want to add is the edge loops around the eyes here. It's a little bit too low res, so we have to add some extra resolution to bring those eyes out. And also for rigging purposes, because if you don't have enough resolution around the eyes, then you can't really rig the eyelids. So it's quite critical that we add a little bit of extra resolution there. I'm not going to add too much at this point. I'm just going to add just enough so I can get a little bit more detail out of those eyes there.